afternoon's patient blood management session. It is excellent to see so many people near the end of the year, still excited and enthusiastic to come, and it's really wonderful to have all of you here. It's our last meeting of the year, and before I introduce our speaker of the day, I would just like to give a special thanks to all the speakers who have made the BBM sessions a great success this year. We've had many sessions and many people interested, and we hope and trust that this will grow in 2024. But it's been a wonderful year, and we've all learned so much. I would just like to also specifically mention that this GastroEcho platform, especially for those who are with us for the first time, is hosted by the Gastro Foundation. And a big thanks to Prof. Chris Kassianides on the screen, who's been a great partner and also a champion of not only all the gastroenterology and hepatology meetings, but also the patient blood management ones. These meetings are hosted, GEcho meetings, in association with Project Echo from the University of New Mexico. Every Wednesday, there's a different theme. And every 4 to 6 weeks, we typically have a patient blood management session. So without further ado, I would love to introduce our speaker of the day, Dr. Lorenzo Boretti. And I love the way he introduces himself as a family man first, which is certainly something I can associate with. But he's also a specialist anesthetist. He's head of the clinical unit for anesthesia at Livingston Tertiary Hospital in the Eastern Cape. He's passionate about healthcare excellence, diversity, equity, and serves as the SASA Eastern Cape chairperson and council member. He loves to enjoy and explore nature and wildlife. So he's not just a man putting people... Doesn't sound right to say putting people to sleep. It sounds a bit serious. Getting people to go to sleep during surgery, he's got many other interests. So Lorenzo is going to talk to us today about an issue that I think is particularly important in settings where resources are not as widely available as one would like them to be. And cell salvage has become one of the cornerstones of patient blood management. Saving the patient's own blood during surgery, getting it back to them, has been shown to be an incredible way to limit blood loss, to improve patient outcomes, to decrease the need for allogeneic red cell transfusion. And that might all sound good and well, but getting the needed equipment, the disposables, and all the other elements, that's not always that easy to do in practice. So Lorenzo has had a interesting and a productive collaboration with the South African National Blood Service. And we all look forward, Lorenzo, to hear how you've solved this problem, how you've tackled it and managed it, and how do you sustain access to these resources. So thank you so much for agreeing with so much enthusiasm to speak to us today. Really wonderful. And we look forward to listening to you, and I'm going to hand it over to you at this point. Thank you.
Thanks, Prof. It's a real pleasure to be on the platform. I'm just going to share my screen. Sorry, guys, my computer doesn't like to play games with me. Start. Okay. Can we all see that?
Perfect. We can see it. Thank you.
Sorry for the delay, guys. So it's not your conventional, very academic talk. It's more an operational type of talk, like Vernon was saying. So it's a little bit different from what I'm used to in giving more academic talks. But yeah, stick with me, and I hope we all learn a lot from my experience. Just some disclaimers. The project was done with the South African National Blood Service. They provide the consumables. Vertice were the company that also supplied the cell saver equipment itself, the machine itself, but we didn't get any other funding or any incentive from Vertice themselves. The other more lighthearted declarations that I must just say that I am a bit of a junkie of generative AI. So you might see some generative AI stuff in my talk. I also, as a side hustle, I secretly plot the demise and downfall of the supply chain, simply because we have so many troubles with it in the state sector. So I think we can all identify with all the issues. So before we go ahead, when I was about 2 years ago, just as we were coming out of COVID, I was sitting in a webinar just pretty much like this one, and Vernon was there, and Dr. Patrice Vessels was also there from SANBS. And I think we were doing a survey or so. I can't remember what we're doing, but it turned out Patrice was discussing some results that she had found out about how doctors in resource areas were struggling with consumables, and that's why they weren't using the cell saver. And then she all of a sudden said, what about doing a project where SANBS provide the consumables, because our procurement is obviously a little bit better, and the clinical governance around SANBS is obviously of high quality, which it needs to be. And when I heard this, I mean, I immediately put my hand up. Vernon was there at the time, and by the end of the webinar, I started a project with SANBS, and a week later, I met up with Petrolise and Debbie Stradom, who I think is in the audience today, and we started this consumables provision to my hospital, which has proven to be a great project, and it just kind of told me like even though you're sitting in these webinars, I think you just need to take just remind yourself that these webinars are actually quite useful. You never know what you're going to come across, and just sticking up your virtual hand and wanting to collaborate has really helped me, and has shown me things in my hospital that I never knew really existed. But so we're going to continue now and give you a little bit of an outline of the talk. First of all, I'm just going to give you an introduction. I'm not going to talk directly just immediately about the collaboration, just a brief overview of what cell salvage is and some of its benefits. And then eventually we'll finish off with the collaboration and talk about the kind of results we were getting and our experiences. So, yes, I think in the audience, we have a number of experts in patient blood management. I think we all agree that we're very much passionate about saving blood and not providing allogeneic blood to our patients. But today I want to shift our focus slightly from the broader aspects of PBM and focus more on this pillar two. Pillar one and pillar three, as we know, is optimizing hematopoiesis and harnessing and optimizing physiological tolerance for anemia, respectively. But in pillar two is where the cell salvage comes in, where we want to minimize bleeding and blood loss and provide the patient with as minimal allogeneic blood as possible, and also to alleviate the demand of allogeneic blood and thereby improve the situation at SANBS. I quite enjoyed this image that I prompted through generative AI, noticing all the blood coming out of the central pillar. So instead of talking broadly about patient blood management, really going to go into, as Venon was saying, the consumables aspect of it, and how we're going to just speak about operationally what cell salvage is about, and how the fact that a small thing like consumables might seem small in the supply in a big supply chain, but not having that consumable has far-reaching effects on our patient blood management efforts, especially in my hospital, where the absence of a consumable can actually really affect the mindset of clinicians and their perception of patient blood management. So I'm going to dive now into the whole magic of cell salvage. And really, it's for those of us who do it, we know that it's not the easiest thing under the sun to do if you haven't done it. But once you get to do it and you get to do it a few times, you find that the equipment now that's available is pretty good. But essentially, it's about collecting, processing, and reinfusing the patient's own blood lost during surgery. And you can see here in this diagram that I obtained from the BJA, your patient, there is the collection into a reservoir. And then from there, the reservoir goes into a processing unit through some form of centrifuging, and then gets put into a bag, and then gets reinfused back into the patient. So the primary aim here is to actually minimize, is to collect as much as possible back from the patient without actually disrupting the red blood cells and cells. The importance is that it reduces the need for the donor blood transfusion, but more importantly, it also minimizes the exposure of the patient to allogeneic blood and all the risks that we know is associated with it. So diving into a little bit deeper, so the three stages of blood rescue of the blood rescue mission starts off with collection and goes on to processing and reinfusion, like I was saying. In the collection section, it's not the same kind of suction that the orthopod or the surgeon uses, but essentially it has to be sucked up in some way. So in our hospital, we used swabs and a special suction device, which is provided with the consumables. It's a double lumen type of tubing, and the one tube has got heparin running down, 25,000 units in a liter of normal saline, and that is dripped in so that the blood doesn't coagulate as it's being collected. The swabs are put into a bowl with normal saline and heparin again, and once there are enough swabs, you suck that mixture up as well, and you'll be surprised as to how much blood you can get from swabs. I actually think sometimes it's more than what you get from the suction. Once the collection is complete, the machine actually prompts you and says, hey, you've collected enough blood now, let's get on to processing. And you start processing, and you can see there are three systems by which you can process. We use a fixed bowl system, but there's a variable volume disc and a continuous rotary systems, which are quite fancy, but the simple basic ones are the fixed bowl systems, and we find it quite reproducible and quite efficient. So essentially the blood comes into this bowl and starts spinning around, and the heavier blood, red blood cells move to the outside, as is indicated in the picture, and the plasma moves higher up. Once the wash comes in, the plasma gets washed away, and including all the heparin also gets washed away. So you get left with really just red blood cells, which then get reconstituted with normal saline or whatever your wash solution is. I've been dabbling around with the Ringer's lactate, but I've recently seen the literature says that Ringer's lactate, for no specific reason, is not preferred over normal saline. But normal saline is what we generally use now. And that gets reconstituted to a hematocrit of about 50 to 70%, and the machine does this automatically. You need to keep an eye on this at this point, because I have had some instances where you look like you're collecting a mountain full of blood, and only to find that the hematocrit is extremely low and something has gone wrong with the washing. So once you've got your blood inside a bag, you are now ready to reinfuse the blood. What the recommendations are is that you need to reinfuse this blood within 6 hours of collection and within 4 hours of it being in the bag. So this whole process works quite efficiently, and I've found it quite useful, especially for my Jehovah's Witness patients. You sometimes get a mixed response from the patients and the liaison, but the liaisons are usually quite open to cell salvage. It's the patients that sometimes wonder what are worried about the break or this discontinuity in the whole process. But I've never come across a Jehovah's Witness that is not open to cell salvage. They might ask a lot of questions, and once you provide the information, they are more than happy to continue with cell salvage. So those would be the three stages of it. The benefits and considerations that we need to think about here. So first of all, like I was saying, it does reduce the dependency on donor blood, but it also does offer a superior oxygen delivery compared to donor blood. The patient's own blood is, if used within the 6 hours, is far more capable of carrying oxygen than allogeneic blood. It also avoids a lot of the immunological reactions and transfusion-related complications that we know of, such as trally and trim and taco. Well, taco not really, because we could overload there as well. But the trally and the trim are definitely transfusion-related immune modulation, and the transfusion-associated lung injuries are obviously a lot lower when you use the patient's own blood. It doesn't go without its issues, though. In areas where there's a lot of resources, anaesthetists are quite happy because they generally have a perfusionist or a technologist that is helping out during the setup of the process. In my setting, though, we don't have a technologist, and we end up doing most of this. So it is quite a laborious task, and the guidelines from the anesthesia guidelines that are provided by the, I think it's the American College of Anesthesia, say that it takes 10 minutes and then 15 minutes for processing. But ultimately, when you're in the thick of resuscitating a patient and there's blood loss, you really do need an extra pair of hands to deal with the cell saver. And that those extra pair of hands at least needs to know how to use the equipment. So training of staff is quite imperative. And then you also need to know, you also need to have a good support system behind you from SANBS and from the supply of the equipment. And there's something that we have found very useful in our department is to have that collaboration between the supplier and SANBS to make this a lot easier. Certain patients it's not suitable for, such as some of the hemoglobinopathies like sickle cell anemia. And there is a complication of something called reinfusion hypertension, but I've never come across reinfusion hypertension in my time reinfusing blood to patients. But you'll see later on that we actually didn't end up reinfusing a lot of blood. It's an interesting result, but I'm sure you're going to enjoy it. One thing that's quite clear when you start looking at the literature around cell salvage and the benefits and the costs is that there's a wide variety of opinions out there. And the actual cost benefits aren't always as clear as what everyone makes them out to be. And it really depends on where the people are using the cell saver and when they compare directly the cell salvaged situation to the amount of blood that is saved for that specific operation, you get a lot of variability. So, for example, Beaton et al. This year presented a result in the American Surgeon, which highlighted the cost effectiveness of cell salvage technology in trauma blood transfusions. This study underscores that cell salvage potential in specific contexts, especially in trauma care, was really beneficial. But there are other studies, like in the cardiac theaters, that have shown that it's not always beneficial to use cell salvage. Well, it is always beneficial, but it's not always cost effective. And some people actually say that you shouldn't be using it. So there is some controversy around when and when not to use cell salvage. In the obstetric patient, there are some papers out there that indicate that you shouldn't be setting up a cell saver for every single cesarean section that you perform. And then there's some that say that there is some benefit to be had for ectopic pregnancies and the like. A recent Cochrane review said it was marginally beneficial to use the Cell Saver, and locally in 2013, a study that came out of the KwaZulu-Natal showed that there was a normal, when you compared the cost of the amount of red blood cells that were reinfused as a result of the Cell Saver, it was the same as or a little bit less than the Cell Saver consumable costs themselves. So this graph over here illustrates the results that came out of that study, illustrating that the blood that they actually, over the period of the study, the amount of blood that they were able to recover was according to the SANBS pricing scheme, was in the region of about 258,000 Rand. And you know, taking into the depreciation of the machine and the consumables and everything, the cost for cell salvage was actually 263,000 Rand. So you can see there's some minimal benefits to be had if you take out of the depreciation of the machine. But the one thing with these results is, and if you go further and you look at the actual cost of a red cell concentrate, and you look at the SANBS pricing, you'll see, and I've just recently got a quote from Vertice for the cost of the consumables. And this price for the consumables is on a discount to the state. So when the KwaZulu-Natal group did their study, that was in 2013, and that was long before inflation really hit us and the prices of cell salvage consumables has really gone up. These prices for the red cell concentrate and the transfusion crossmatch and the blood on a returnable basis and after hours fee, I had to put those in to increase the price a little bit, are what SANBS were offering in March 2023. The prices have gone up a little bit since then, but they are definitely not in the region of 4,485. So you can see that the cost in order to make a cost benefit on a specific red blood cell, on a specific cell salvage consumable compared to SANBS, you're going to have to at least be transfusing 2 units of blood, and that's only for that specific patient. But it does dawn on me that what does this all mean? It suggests that maybe for the true value of cell salvage, maybe lies in beyond the straightforward metrics, though, because most of these studies don't really take into account the overall blood transfusion that occurs around cell salvage. So they don't look at the overall theater consumption of blood. They look at the specific that operation's blood, and obviously at times that can be to the disadvantage of cell salvage when comparing. In our study, we looked at more the overall usage of blood in the theater. And looked at all surgical procedures and to see if providing the consumables would be of benefit. And I think the results that you'll see are quite interesting when it comes to this. But this is quite an important slide just to remember what the cost of blood is through SANBS. And obviously the cost of infusing allogeneic blood is a lot more than this, because it incorporates the length of stay and the length of recovery and all the adverse effects that can also be incorporated, that should be incorporated when thinking about holistically about the patient. Okay, so looking at our project, which the objectives of the project was really to assess the effect of an enhanced cell salvage technology consumable availability on blood transfusion frequency and related testing practices within the surgical departments. So in essence, we really wanted to make sure that we had enough consumables so that took away the variable of there weren't enough consumables to be able to use the Cell Saver. And from there, we wanted to see how that was going to affect our transfusion practices. We anticipated, and obviously, if we have the Cell Saver always available, that the overall usage of donor blood would decrease. And as likewise, cross-matching and type and screening would also decrease. So when we looked at implementation of our collaboration with SANBS, we sat down with two suppliers initially, and then we eventually got down to choosing Vertice. And SANBS at this point, through Dr. Petrelis Vessels and Debbie Stradom, we ended up, they were able to actually donate 40 units, consumable units, to the to this project. In hindsight, I'm still questioning whether we should have set up a procurement system, but I think it would have been a little bit more difficult to actually be able to create the whole procurement system where the hospital would actually pay for the consumables and see how that all worked out. But I think the provision of the cell savers through the SANBS was the best option. So what actually happened was the consumables were stored at the blood bank. And the doctors had to use the blood bank form, which I think we're all familiar with, to order the consumables. In this way, the data collection was also a lot easier because SANBS are very good at collecting patient blood management data, as well as all the other data that goes on that form. That's provided that the doctors or the healthcare workers actually put the information on the form. And we do have a problem, and I think there's a lot of people out there that will resonate with us, that the forms are sometimes not completed in full. Once we had this process by which we were going to collect, provide this, the consumables, we had to develop protocol and implement the training. The protocol was based on the guidelines that you'll see in the references, and also on our current practice as well. Once we had developed the protocol, what we did was we created a flow chart, and the flow chart, I'll show you the flow chart, is really a discussion-based flow chart where we created it so that it's not vague. You'll see it's not vague, but it provides an opportunity for the anaesthetist, the nurse and the surgeon to get together and discuss the case, so that the risk of blood loss and cell salvage necessities can be discussed, and a plan can be made. Once we had created this flowchart, I went around to all the departments and did a couple of training sessions, which also yielded some interesting results. Some interesting discussions were had with the various departments and the perceptions of people's ideas around the transfusion of blood were also quite interesting to be able to find out. Like I said, the data, collecting the data was actually made a lot easier by the collaboration with SANBS. And given the fact that SANBS already collects all this data for us, it was really easy for me to identify any benefits and to identify who was using the cell saver and when. So if you look at the slide, there is a this is basically the consumables that you get for the cell saver. And over here, this is the reservoir, which I refer to as the hard shell, and this is the aspiration and anticoagulation line. You would open up these two when you're collecting the blood, and then this comes in a separate pack, which is, there's a waste section over here. This is your small little centrifuge, and this is your reinfusion bag. And these things go click onto your hard shell. And these are essentially the consumables that you get from SANBS. All this information you can get off the Vertice website, which is, they've got quite an excellent training website where you can go through the whole cell salvage process, and there are videos there to instruct you on how to set up the machine. And I must admit, the support that we had was practically 24 hours, and we just had to send them a WhatsApp, and we had an immediate response as to how to deal with any issues with the machine. So going on to the the protocol that and the flowchart that we created, you'll see that there's a little sidebar here to indicate what the grades of anemia are and what the indications for transfusion are, and how long you can actually keep the blood. But the real discussion points come in this this hierarchy, this tree of hierarchy as well. Essentially, this is what the cell saver looks like with the hard shell and the overall machine, and then the consumables over here, furthermore, the processing consumables. But essentially, when you are presented with a patient, and we try to do this for almost every single patient that we encountered in surgery, and the first thing was to do was to determine the bleeding risk of the procedure. And if it was high risk, we need to then go down to determine whether it was an emergency or if it was non-emergent. And if it was an emergency, we then were able to look at what the level of anemia was, whether it was moderate or no anemia. This then dictated how we would use our consumables. If there was moderate anemia, we would then set up the entire cell salvage unit and hopefully be able to recover some blood. If there was no anemia, the plan there was to only set up the collection unit, which was the hard shell and the aspiration set, and then collect blood and the swabs. And if we were able to reach a certain level where we could actually reinfuse the blood, then we would go ahead and process the blood and then reinfuse. But we didn't open up the processing pack until we had enough blood, which did save a lot of consumables. If it wasn't an emergency operation, we only set up the aspiration and the hard shell units and collected blood and swabs and then only processed once we got to the certain point. In the low risk of bleeding arm, if there was moderate anemia, we again only collected the swabs. We didn't have any aspiration or hard shell open in that situation, but we had the consumables and the machine present in theater. And the reason why we did this was because when we did the training, this was actually adapted after the training, because there were certain perceptions in a number of our surgical teams that, how do I put this, that if the patient had a moderate anemia and they didn't transfuse to a certain level, that the anaesthetist would postpone the case or cancel the case in need of a transfusion. So they would preempt a transfusion based on the fact that we would cancel the case. But bringing in the cell saver afford us that opportunity to identify that this perception and provide them with a little bit of a safety net as well, so that if the patient did bleed with a moderate anemia and a low bleeding risk, then they would have this back this safety net of the swabs. And yes, there were some times when a low risk procedure turned into a procedure that bled a little bit, but when we were able to recover the swabs and reinfuse that blood. So we've on many occasions didn't type and screen or cross matched a patient with an HB of with a hemoglobin of 8 grams per deciliter going in for an operation like a femur fracture or even a bipolar hip replacement, and we'd wait to see if there was any blood that was lost and if we could recover any blood. And thus the orthopedic surgeons found quite reassuring, this whole protocol. So if you look at the actual results for the study, very interesting for me was, it's broken up into two parts. And we look at the metrics and the transfusion impact. Basically, the two parts are who, what, and where. Where were we using the cell saver, what operations, and who were we using it on? The second part was more around the transfusion trends. Did it have an impact on the blood ordering practices? Did it have an impact on the services that SANBS provide, like cross-matching and type and screening? And you'll see that the results we've obtained, so first of all, if you look at the who, what, and where, this is quite a busy slide, but I think it's a nice dashboard that we used to assess how we were doing. If we look at what surgeries we were using the cell saver, we used 29 packs in 6 months. Sorry, I meant to say right at the beginning that for over a period of a year, the first 6 months, we had a period where there was no cell savers because of consumables. Then SANBS provided the collaboration, and from the day one, we measured another 6 months, and we compared the 2 6 months to see how well the presence of consumables were. And during the time that we were that we had cell salvage consumables after the 6 months after, we only used it 29 times, but we did return quite a few packs as well. So we only actually ended up using 23 full kits. And according to the forms, we theater used 82% of them. The other remaining 18% was not documented on the forms. So the type of surgeries that actually used cell salvage was spread between neurosurgery, orthopedics, general surgery, and trauma. There was no category for some of the cases, and cardiothoracics used a very small amount as well. This information, I just want to reiterate, comes directly off the SANBS blood collection form. We can see that for 90% of the time, the full kit was asked for, and only 7% of the time was only the aspiration and hard shell. So hard shell used. Looking at the type of patient that actually got exposed to cell salvage, you can see the histogram here at the bottom, the distribution of the hemoglobin. Interestingly, obviously down here at the level of 4 to 6, a hemoglobin of between 4 and 6, that was where we had a little bit of a spike. And you would expect that if there was very little, if the hemoglobin was a bit low, that someone would open the cell saver. This maybe wasn't expected, but if you think about it, all the trauma that goes on, these patients are generally quite healthy and end up having normal hemoglobins, and the concentration hasn't changed yet. And so patients that are wouldn't say not in, they're in the region of moderate to mild anemia, we were opening up the cell saver for. If you look at the amount of allogeneic units that were transfused with patients that actually where we opened up the cell saver, it's nice to see that of the 23 cell savers that we used, 12 of them didn't end up using any, we didn't end up transfusing any blood from donor blood, that is. But there were other instances where, for example, this patient received 21 units, another patient used 17. So there are some blips around here, and there is this blip around here that's also between 3 and 4, where we received 3 and 4 units of blood. This just indicates that, yes, we can't just rely solely on cell salvage. And at times you will need to introduce allogeneic blood at the same time. But having looking at this table over here, in total, the amount of blood that was reinfused over the 6 month period only equated to 15 units of blood. And at the cost of blood through SANBS, that equates to an amount of a saving of 50,000 Rand. The cost of consumables of 23 packs of consumables is 206,000 Rand. So you can see that clearly this is not a beneficial or cost-effective way of using it. But I think when you look at the next set of results, you're going to see the far-reaching effects of the cell saver. So when we look at the trends, the transfusion trends before and after cell salvage, this is the patient blood management data that SANBS provide to our department. And we find this information extremely useful in order to normalize the situation, because obviously if the theater is shut down in the second half of the study and we only do very few operations, there's also going to be the likelihood of very few blood transfusions happening. And you can see in this text over here that before the procurement improvement, the surgery operations were 1,642, and after there were 1,720 operations. So we've actually increased the number of operations. And this is similar for the orthopedics operations, increasing from 1,739 to 1,760. These two graphs are it's a little bit confusing, but if you look at the legends, you'll see that they are on separate axes. But the blue bar charts are signify the surgical pre-cell saver technology improvement. And you can see that the red cell products that were transfused or ordered was 853, before we had the consumables, and after this red one over here, which is the surgery post the cell salvage improvement, decreased the number of red blood cells down to 723, which is a relatively big saving. But if you look at the orthopedic, but percentage-wise, looking at the orthopedic surgery, I believe is where there was quite a significant drop. Orthopedic the consumables was 176 red cell concentrates were ordered, and subsequently after we had the consumables, 117 were ordered, which is quite a significant decrease in the amount of blood that was needed. The cross-matching also practices also decreased. Both surgeons and orthopods decreased significantly the amount of cross-matches were performed. Type and screening was generally quite low, but also decreased for the surgical, but not for the orthopedics. But these two results over here really did indicate that the made the surgeons and the orthopedic surgeons not want to cross-match blood. We actually implemented that in our training as well to indicate that the presence of the cell saver there means that you didn't need to cross-match blood. And the fact that you were able to actually get reinfused this blood meant that, and the fact that the blood bank was on site meant that you, even if the reinfusion didn't work, you weren't that far away from getting a cross-match. And that changed that was quite a big practice change for the orthopedics and surgical departments. So looking at the results of how much this actually saved, if we look at the cost of a red cell concentrate and the cross-matching save and the cost of the consumables, the annual saving for this for implementing the consumables was 1.1 in the region of 1.1 million. And I think that's also quite an underestimation of what was actually achieved. I think if we had to go into the wards and have really decent data collection and have a more fine-tuned way of assessing which patients were doing better and which patients weren't, and what the surgical site infections were and the length of stay, I think we would definitely pick up a lot more savings that we're having just based on the fact that we weren't transfusing. So you can see here that even though we didn't make rand for rand a cost benefit when you're looking at one patient, if you look at the whole picture, you can see that there's a significant saving to be had by implementing the consumable, by making sure that consumables are available. Okay. So to finish off, this is an ironic picture that I created through a prompt with generative AI. And what I asked ChatGPT to do was to provide me with a picture of a doctor that was successful in their project. Now the initial prompt resulted in a picture of a man in the front, and then there were a number of people in the background. And then I thought, well, no, let's make it a woman. And then I put a woman in the front, and ChatGPT put a woman in the front, but then provided what seems to be the successful images of men with beards in the background, which I do have a beard as well. But I think it's interesting that even generative AI has its biases and its perceptions. And that's kind of like something that I learned from this project, is that there's a lot of perceptions in healthcare, and these perceptions are sometimes not discussed. For example, the orthopedic surgeon's perception was that we would cancel, anaesthetists would cancel lists or patients if they weren't at the right hemoglobin without even discussing. And that was something that we had just taken for granted that they wouldn't be doing. So, I think from our results, we can say that the cell saver itself had a broader impact, much way beyond just direct usage. It has changed the mindset of doctors in the theatre environment. We are now able to push the limits of transfusion and ordering blood, so that we no longer want to order and cross-match a patient that's coming to theatre simply because their hemoglobin is 8 or 9. So we can see that the presence of a simple thing like consumables and the impact that supply chain has on clinical behavior is quite significant. And this does transpire to a lot of other things in theater as well. If the equipment is not available and the consumables are not available, I generally find that clinicians not only do not use them, but find other ways of doing the work. And these other ways are at times less efficient and also at times a little less safe for the patient. And I think the importance of what SANBS has done here in providing the illustration that providing the consumables through a really robust system that has got good clinical governance, such as SANBS, has really illustrated to our patient blood management group that we can change the minds of our clinicians. There's no doubt in my mind that there's significant benefits to be had around the use of consumables and provision of these consumables by SANBS. But I think overall, the ability to collaborate and to communicate is by far more important than just the consumables. The opportunity to raise my virtual hand right at the beginning with Dr. Petrolise Vessels and say that I want to collaborate with SANBS and open those communications has really opened up an entire communication pathway with all sorts of disciplines, including our surgeons, including our nurses, including the suppliers of our equipment. So that's what I found so amazing about attending these webinars is that sometimes you can just sit there and just really suck it all up and just get more information into your head. But other times you can look for opportunities to collaborate and raise your hand and make a big difference in the area that you work in. I don't know how I'm doing for time, but if there are any questions, please feel free to ask. These are the list of references that I used during this presentation. I think of interest to people would be the Association of Anaesthetists guidelines. It's a really good guideline on how to use cell salvage if you want more details, and the BJA education article is a very good one to illustrate how to use it. Yeah, thank you very much. I'll leave you with the image of AI.
Thanks, Loretto. That was great. And it's quite remarkable to see what these AI image generators can do. Thanks for a very practical session. I think a good way to end the year, but also timely, because at the end of the year, we start to think about what we would like to do in the new year. And I think you really inspired us to really take the academics to our practice. And I want to congratulate you and SANBS for finding innovative solutions. It's one of the things I really enjoy working with, about working with SANBS and the Western Cape Blood Service, is that they are really solution orientated. And I want to encourage everyone that if you want to do similar things, please engage. SANBS has taken the bold step of appointing a team of people focused on patient blood management. So, and I see Marius Kutsias in the audience. Marius and the team at the University of the Free State, together with SANBS once again, have started a short learning program in patient blood management that's been very successful. We've just heard the first results of that at the latest International Society for Blood Transfusion conference. Loretta, we've Lorenzo, we've got a question or two here for you. And I'm going to start with something from Dr. Jenny Hull. Jenny's got a lot of experience and background in obstetrics, gynecology, and she asks, do you know what the MCV of your very anemic patients was, and if low, it would suggest a chronic anemia and an increased risk of pulmonary edema. Were any of these patients ectopic pregnancies? So just for the audience who may not be anesthesiologists or hematologists or who don't know this, patients with chronic anemias that are of slow onset expand their plasma volume. So this is the typical patient is the one that walks in the door with a hemoglobin of 2, 3, and 4. And the dangerous thing to do is just to transfuse them, because they compensate it. The moment you give them red cells, you order 2 or 3 red cells because you get this shock of HPF2, you can kill them by causing fluid overload. So thank you, Jenny. Very important comment. Lorenzo, do you want to maybe comment on any of the issues she's raised there?
Jenny, we studied this at Livingston Tertiary Hospital, which doesn't have obstetric or gynecology surgery. So we didn't do it really, but I can tell you that my colleague who works at Doran Ginza Hospital, when we started using this system through SANBS, was very envious and has actually been asking why we didn't do it with the maternity hospital, which is obviously a really good idea to do. But unfortunately, it was just more feasible to do it at Livingston Hospital. I must admit, we do look at the MCVs when we get given the full blood count. Often we'll only get hemoglobin, and not the MCV. But often we also find that sometimes the MCVs aren't low, and sometimes the iron deficiency is not significant enough yet to create a drop in the MCV. So we didn't really pick up too many of that, but when we do our reinfusions, it's really based on a response to a requirement for infusion. So we won't just simply infuse patients. We'll use the pulse pressure variation or various tests to see if the patient will respond to infusion. So we won't necessarily push the patient into pulmonary edema.
No, wonderful. I think this is really an important tip that I want to also just point out that Jenny is giving us here. And it also illustrates the point Lorenzo is referring to. Iron deficiency anemia is the end stage of iron deficiency. So some people divide it in a stage 1, 2, and 3. First stage, there's iron deficiency, but no anemia yet, although it's got a lot of consequences for the patient. You don't see anemia. Stage 2, MCV is normal. It's only in stage 3 when these MCVs are low. There's a very good tip to look for that, because it tells you this didn't happen from yesterday. This is probably of long-standing nature. Lorenzo, second question from Professor Marius Kutsia, who used to be head of hematology, hematopathology at the University of the Free State and very involved still as emeritus professor in patient blood management. In your practice, which procedures, which were the procedures where cell salvage showed the most benefit?
Yeah, so I'll give you a personal experience of a recent patient, and for me the most benefit would be for a Jehovah's Witness patient. Really, we've recently had a young Jehovah's Witness patient that came in and had an accident and had some internal bleeding, and at this point that for me was the most benefit. We were able to even though it wasn't a lot of blood, we were able to get back sufficient enough blood so that the patient didn't need a transfusion. And those intra-abdominal infusions where intra-abdominal collections can be quite useful at times. And I know some people shy away from it. There's no real absolute contraindication to collecting blood from the abdomen. Obviously, if it's really soiled, I would be hesitant. But the washing and the use of leukodepleted filters also helps out quite a bit. But again, if the abdomen is quite sore, then you'd have to do a risk assessment and see if you want to go ahead. But what was quite surprising for me was how much blood we could get back from an orthopedic operation. Using the swabs and suction, I was actually very surprised, because it's not something that you would normally do for a femur fracture. You would generally use it for major hips, the major joints. But I was very surprised at how we were able to get quite a bit of blood back in the orthopedic operations. But having said that, if you look at the results that we did, I think having the Soul Saver so available, we used it on operations that weren't generally always regarded as Soul Saver used. And I think we did that. It really helped in changing the mindset of orthopedic surgeons and surgeons in our environment to say, hey, I've got a safety net now, so I can go ahead and not use cross-matched or allogeneic blood products. So the real benefit here wasn't on a case-to-case basis, but on the mindset change that it created within our surgical disciplines.
Lorenzo, thank you very much. I would just like to quickly share something that you also alluded to in your talk, and just get my screen ready again. So one of the things you alluded to that I think is a very important concept that all of us that are interested in patient blood management should know about is the concept of activity-based costs. So as Lorenzo pointed out, it's not just the acquisition costs, but also what are the hidden costs related to blood transfusion. And here's examples of red cell transfusions, platelet transfusions, and even plasma. Now, in all cases, the same principle was demonstrated, but I want to show you this. So
excuse me,
if you
Bernard,
look at the, yes?
It's not sharing.
Is it not sharing? Oh,
no.
That's interesting. It says...
It says you started the share, but we're not seeing it.
It's not showing. Okay, your screen share is loading. I'm sorry about that. Just for time's sake, I'll just read. So what I'm showing on my screen at the moment is an article from Transfusion, which is the major blood transfusion journal. And what it basically shows is that you have not only acquisition costs when it comes to blood transfusion, but also activity-based costs, which includes all the process steps, the staff, and the consumables that you need for red cell transfusions, in this case, in surgical patients. And there are direct and indirect overhead costs. And basically, in this health economics study, they showed that the activity-based costs, this is not including the cost of actually just paying for the red cells, were 3.2 to 4.8 fold higher than blood product acquisition costs. So millions of rands and dollars in that case goes into the additional costs surrounding a blood transfusion. And that needs to be considered for plasma, for red cells, and platelets when you do a health economic study. So I think that's just something useful to know. If there are, let me just double check. If there are no other specific questions, I see there are some people that were very happy with your presentation. Thank you for that. I think this was really great. I hope you're going to continue to prospectively also collect further data, and hopefully we'll see this published at some stage, Lorenzo. Really exciting stuff. Looks like a nice MED project or something like that.
Yes, we are definitely planning on publishing with SANBS. Yeah.
Wonderful. Wonderful. They are a great team to work with in that regards, and I can really encourage everyone to grab the opportunity. We've reached the end of the hour, so I would just like to again say a big thank you to Lorenzo today, but all our speakers in the course of this year for wonderful, wonderful sessions. Thanks to the iEcho University New Mexico team, as well as the iEcho India team, who've provided technical support. All of these sessions are recorded and will be available on the Gastro Foundation website. So you can go back to them and or in your journal clubs, in your hospitals, show these presentations, share it with your colleagues, get the conversation going. We really want to see more and more people roll out the different pillars of PBM. So a big thank you to our presenters, a big thank you to Cheryl, Valentine, to Karen, who works in the background that makes this happen. And Chris, again, you are the father of all of this. We really appreciate you and what you do. Thank you so much. And there's lots of people agreeing with me there in the chat. We're really, really grateful for all the wonderful things you're doing. So next week will be endoscopy. There are no more patient blood management sessions for the year, but for the gastroenterologist in the audience, there is one more GEcho session on lower endoscopy, which will be the last meeting for 2023. And with that, I wish you all a wonderful evening and goodbye. Thank you.
Thanks, Lorenzo. Cheers.